Hi, this is Abram Hindle from the Department of Computing Science at University of Alberta. This is the requirements lecture for Compute 301. So requirements are very important when you're developing software, mostly because later on they tend to be the cause of failures. If you notice this chart from this chaos report, 13% of requirements, or 13% of failures are blamed on incomplete requirements. 12% on lack of user involvement, which could be involved in elicitation of requirements. 10% on unrealistic expectations, which could be a limitation of the requirements. 8.7% regarding changing requirements. And then 8.1% on lack of planning, which oftentimes is relevant to requirements. Thus, if we want to avoid project failure, we probably have to address requirements and address them successfully. Requirements come in many shapes and sizes. Some kinds of requirements include user requirements. These are basically the tasks that the user can do with the system or the tasks that the user wants to do to the system. It could be something like is capable of building and deploying a coffee to a user. Functional requirements are basically the behaviors that the system does or support. They're essentially the features. A functional requirement might be using a wizard style of interaction. The program can help a user build a DVD. That is basically a feature, wizard style DVD building. Other features could be saving to different file formats, things like that. Then there's non-functional requirements. Non-functional requirements are oftentimes qualities or sometimes referred to as illities. They include how well a system operates and how well it should do what it does. These non-functional requirements can range from things like portability, reliability, to functionalities such as security, which aren't quite features but are sort of cross-cutting concerns, into others such as maintainability, portability, and other kinds of qualities that one would seek in software, like usability. So these are there three different kinds of requirements. There's other kinds, such as external interfaces. Sometimes when you're building software, it needs to deal with the hardware and software systems that you have. For instance, if you saw a neat iOS game and you liked it, but you wanted to run it on your Android phone, you would have to look for an implementation of the game that met the external requirements of running on an Android phone. Furthermore, you might care about what data formats your software uses, what protocols, what data it requires, what hardware it interfaces with. For instance, on a touchscreen, you don't necessarily want to rely on software that expects you to have a right mouse button or expects your cursor to be visible and moved around without clicking at all times. You might only want software that can deal with simply drags and clicks. Anything else you can't do with a touch screen. There's also other requirements regarding the physical setting. If you are building software that's meant to run in a machine that's operating in a factory, it might have to be relatively rugged. If it's in a safety critical scenario, like a rocket ship, perhaps you have to address the safety concerns. If it's in a environment with lots of children, the physical implementation will have to be quite rugged, and probably you would have to avoid making the interface error prone, and furthermore you'd have to make the interface approachable by children. This might even include things like having a kiosk that's at the height for children. Then there's developer constraints. What is your team composed of? Who is on your team? What technologies are they used to? And furthermore, what documentation do we have to meet? There's even more kinds of requirements. We have business requirements. Why are we bothering to build the system? Why is it needed? In many cases, the software that you write will be business systems, and they will try to automate processes being followed by current businesses. Thus, the fact that a business follows that process and seeks to have it automated is oftentimes the reason a system is needed. When a system is needed, there's often business constraints that must be dealt with. whether the system or process must comply with policies, standards, laws, regulations, contracts, legal licensing issues, anything of the sort. There are oftentimes a lot of business constraints. There might also be a lot of resource constraints like funding and all that. So, just to review, we got business constraints, business requirements, developer constraints, physical settings, external interfaces, user requirements, functional requirements, and non-functional requirements. There are many different kinds of requirements. So, these requirements, when they are specified, they should probably be correct. The requirements should represent what the user wants and needs. Furthermore, they should be complete. They should describe all the possible scenarios. They should be consistent. They shouldn't contradict each other. If you say the entire application should be different tones of blue, and then you want red buttons, is that a contradiction or is that an inconsistency? Will you get irritated when there's no red buttons, or will you get irritated when there are red buttons? Other consistent requirements could be regarding the hardware being used and the performance requirements. For instance, if you want to say crack passwords very quickly, and you're only given say Atmel AVR chips that run on Arduinos, you probably have a contradiction between your performance requirements and your external requirements of the hardware you're using. Furthermore, requirements should be clear. There should be no ambiguities, and you should work hard to work out any ambiguities. Ambiguities can occur many times because not enough requirements have been elicited, but also the words used to describe the requirements mean multiple things to multiple parties. Parties should come to an agreement on the vocabulary being used such that they can actually make useful requirements. Furthermore, the requirements should be realistic, and not even just realistic for all programmers. They should be realistic for the programmers in the team being addressed. If the team can't realistically do something, then those requirements will not be met. Requirements should also be traceable. Traceability means that you can trace the functionality from the requirements and the tests, or you can trace the functionality from the code and tests to the requirements that are being satisfied. That is, if you make a change that fixes a bug, you should be aware which requirement is being dealt with or achieved by fixing that bug. Furthermore, any feature should be obvious with respect to what requirements it came from. This might require using an issue tracker, and this might require heavy documentation. Might also require describing the work being done very carefully in terms of linking. Other kinds of traceability include linking to other artifacts like source code, documentation, issue trackers, and requirements should be just as traceable. One should mention which requirement they're being dealt with. Traceability is sometimes a concern, so you might consider that you name your requirements. For instance, here are the requirements of SQLite. SQLite made these requirements later in life, at the end of their version 3s. They made these requirements and they named them. They named them because they could then refer to these requirements in version control systems. The numbering system doesn't really matter, but the fact is they have unique names. So you can see that there's requirements. The commit command may be used to release all save points and commit the transaction, even if the transaction was originally started by a save point command instead of a begin command. And they provide a source, and they provide a requirements name. So if you fix a bug relevant to this kind of issue, you might want to reference this requirement. Requirements should also be verifiable. That is, you should be able to make repeatable tests, and you should be able to design a test to show that the system fulfills that requirement. So if we go and look at that example again, the commit command may be used to release save points. We should be able to make a test where we have a save point, and then we test to see if the commit command actually does release that save point. So, Good requirements are verifiable. We can verify that we met them. So, what is verifiable? Is this statement verifiable? The system shall have a good user interface. Think about it for a second. It's actually not that verifiable because we don't have a good definition of a good user interface. The system shall respond to the user in under 1 second for most tasks. That's verifiable. We can simply test it and time it and run a benchmark to be sure that the system responds within the necessary amount of time. We can measure the system. It is verifiable. When the output state changes, it is logged to the event log. Is this verifiable? Yes, it is. It's pretty easy to change the output state and then go check the log to see if it mentions that the output state has changed. This, the system shall be free of defects, is it verifiable? Probably not. It's very hard to verify this. We could try to prove things or we could try to test things, but it's very, very difficult. And testing doesn't necessarily prove that it's free of defects. Oftentimes defects have to be found. So, we've got requirements. We've asked if they're verifiable. Next, how do we deal with requirements? What are the activities we take part in to get requirements and work on requirements? Well, the first step is usually requirements elicitation. This is where we discover user needs. We talk to the users. And we try to figure out what the requirements are. We should also try to make sure the vocabulary is consistent. Then we do requirements analysis. We analyze the requirements we elicited from the user. We try to decide the scope and the priorities. We oftentimes engage in the user to figure out what their priorities are. And we can study feasibility. If we don't quite understand what the user wants, we can create makeups and study to see if we can figure out if we can achieve the kind of system that they are looking for. Perhaps by providing them with a pen and paper example of their software, they can tell us if they like it or not. Then, once we've elicited the requirements, sort of figured out what the requirements are, we can make a requirement specification. We can detail the requirements in terms that users can understand, and then we can iteratively repeat this operation to discover if the user has any needs based on that further and if we have to do any further analysis. So, we want to elicit requirements from the user. We want to do requirements analysis to clean it up, figure out the scope, figure out what we're not going to do, prioritize things, study the feasibility, maybe try a couple of mock-ups to figure out what we're doing. Then, once we got those mock-ups and the user likes them, we can specify it. And then we can give it back to the users so they can see if they agree with our ideas about their requirements. So the user is typically the end user in a primary setting. They're the end user and they have frequent hands-on use. They might not be the person buying, they might not be the person paying for it. A secondary user would be the managers of the end users. They might use it occasionally. They might use an assistant. They might use an admin interface. And there's tertiary users. They might be the owners of the system. They use the outputs. Maybe they rely on some of the analysis of the system. Nonetheless, they sometimes are the people who pay for the system and thus are responsible for setting priorities or setting how much they feel things are worth. So when you deal with users, you should consider their background. The users are basically the audience to your software. You have to consider their literacy and language. For instance, lots of software is developed for developers, and it's developed for developers in their mother tongue as well as their mother tongue programming language. So you might have an English language that was implemented in PHP if you're programming in PHP. That might be the audience. Furthermore, you have to consider if the users are not developers, what kind of literacy and language they have. Do they know much about computers? Can they read very well? What language do they speak in? What culture do they come from? What symbols do they understand? Furthermore, are they motivated to learn your software or not? A kiosk that you step up to and just try to extract some information from before going off, like say a map in a mall, you have minimal motivation to learn. and if it doesn't give you the answer soon, you'll leave frustrated very quickly. Furthermore, consider the domain knowledge of the user. Do they know a lot about the domain? Are they very familiar? If you are dealing with shipping, are you dealing with a customer where they want to ship something? Or are you dealing with a shipper who needs to know about agreements between various entities who take responsibility for packages as they pass in and out of their hands? Furthermore, you have to consider if the user is familiar with the task. If they're familiar with the task, you can use the metaphors and the domain knowledge and objects that are associated with that task. If they are not familiar with the task, you probably have to provide some tutorial about that. Furthermore, you should consider computer skills and the attitude to computers and technologies. For instance, some people who are, say, older than the age of 30 have a different attitude when it comes to computers and software. They come from an era where computers and software and machinery was easy to damage and wasn't really designed for express usability or exploration. They read manuals to figure out how to use machinery and software. Nowadays, you're expected to be able to use software via exploration. This expectation is not necessarily shared with these users, and they might not explore as much as you would hope. So sometimes you have to provide documentation to your audience. Furthermore, you should consider the characteristics of users. For instance, they might have different perceptual, motor, and tactile abilities. They might have difficulty seeing or hearing. They might be colorblind. They might be deaf. They might be mildly blind. They might have poor vision. They might need big fonts. Or they might have really excellent vision, and they might need a very information-dense screen, so you might have to use small fonts. They might have very fine motor skills. You might be making a drawing application for artists who have really excellent hand-eye coordination when it comes to using a stylus. So you might have to address that kind of scenario with input devices. Whereas you might be dealing with children whose motor skills are developing and interesting and not necessarily very fine or exact. There might be physical limitations. For instance, a kiosk at a museum for children might have to be quite low. A kiosk at a museum that is attended by the rest of the public might have to be a little bit higher. You might consider different hand-finger sizes. So if you make a mobile device, you might consider making a version of it that's a lot larger for people with very large hands. You might also consider the health and age and gender of the population that you're dealing with. Furthermore, there's social issues that one can deal with. Culture dictates symbols and symbology that you can use. Relationships with peers can also affect how the users act, especially if there's any social aspect to the software that's being dealt with. Furthermore, the social aspect might imply some kind of level of authority or power relationships, so you might have to take that into account. Consider the kinds of uses when it comes to users. So there's an infrequent use, novice user stereotype, where they like wizard UIs that say, do you want to do this or this? Click next. And then they have clear prompts and you need error handling. Frequent users, like expert users, oftentimes look for shortcuts within the software. They want keyboard shortcuts, they want to customize their software, they want to program it. If you think about Apple products tend to be more in this infrequent use zone, where frequent tasks are promoted and more finicky customization tasks, like say printing 4UP, are hidden away. Furthermore, a lot of Apple products tend to lack programmability and customization, which is generally used on more expert users because they focus more on a novice user set. Whereas if you look at a Unix desktop, oftentimes they do not address novice users very well. Oftentimes they're very cryptic and unclear, and you rely heavily on keyboard shortcuts, customizations, programmability. If you talk about a Unix desktop to many people, they know what .dot files are. Novice users do not know what .dot files are. So there are some issues to consider. Users cannot always express what they want. So when you're eliciting requirements, users don't always know what they want, and they usually know what they like. This is nice. This aspect of users is nice because it means if you show them something, they can give you an opinion. Furthermore, users are not programmers. Users do not have great experience with software, so they might not know what is possible. They might not know what is technically possible or what is economically feasible. They might not understand that it's very difficult to make a user interface like Tom Cruise's user interface in Minority Report, where you're throwing images around with your hands. You might be able to pull it off with the Kinect now, but it might be hard for your development team, whereas a simple gallery might be easier. Furthermore, you have to watch out. Users have an idea, and oftentimes this idea is based on things they already know. So if they're in an office environment, they probably know a lot about forms, and they know a lot about the office processes. They might not have thought about other alternatives to these forms or the office processes. So they might post things in ways they've already done it. A lot of users will, say, post things in the software they like to use, like a spreadsheet. Some of them want to use everything like a spreadsheet and feel comfortable in that paradigm. They might not know other paradigms. If you are automating an office business process, you might run into users, stakeholders, who fear the loss of their job. They might not provide constructive information for you, and they might not participate in a constructive manner. So you have to watch out, because you might be on their turf. So one thing you should watch out for, this is sort of like the time on The Simpsons where Homer's brother, who was making cars, invited Homer to design the car for the everyman. So they built this monstrosity of a car, and it addressed every one of Homer's needs, but it did not address the rest of the population's need. This is slightly related to Innovator's Dilemma. This is basically, as the user base for an application grows, there's a tendency for the developers to focus on the increasingly expert and vocal group of users. Expert users oftentimes are capable of interacting in ways that normal users are not. They oftentimes can use bug reports, they can oftentimes add things to the issue tracker, they can discuss lots of things. And thus, they tend to be overrepresented. In order to get representation from other kinds of users, one should probably employ focus groups or actually pay people to put people together into a room to actually evaluate your product to make sure that the requirements are appropriate. So the issue with the innovator's dilemma is that the developers will focus on expert users. And this often means that the system becomes more sophisticated, it becomes more optimized for them. Also means someone can come in underneath and eat their lunch with a simpler version of the system. The issue is that new users oftentimes need less, and experts don't want their apps dumbed down. So one might consider having like different kinds of user profiles or layers, but it adds a lot of complication to the application. Getting scooped is a very big problem. Competitors can attract a new user by giving them a simple, good enough app. So a lot of initial criticisms to some Apple products were, oh, I can do this and more already with the device I have. But that wasn't necessarily what the rest of the population was looking for. They might have just been looking to play music. And thus, that original app loses the market share due to that disruption. So, we're dealing with people. So this is soft skills. This is important soft social skills. You have to deal with people. So you have to try to understand them. One thing you can address is their expectations. To manage their expectations, be clear and honest about the claims that you make. Your software won't solve all problems, but if it will have problem cases, don't surprise them. Tell them about them. You don't want to overhype it. And you don't want them disappointed when they use their software. One way to improve understanding, especially in terms of requirements elicitation, is to involve the user in building prototypes to gain feedback. They will more likely forgive if they are actually involved in the process. Furthermore, you want to correlate terminology. You want to establish a glossary that's used in the application domain. Not necessarily what your programmers are using, but what the users actually use. Then it will help the programmers to actually take those terms and name objects and classes according to those terms, because then when they explain issues to a user, it will be in the terms the user understands. All right. The next presentation on requirements will be on user requirements, but I want to review what we went over here. We went over requirements elicitation, understanding the user, the issues with listening to a small set of users, the issues with talking with users, because they don't always know what they want, but oftentimes they know what they don't like, the different stereotypes of users, from infrequent use novice users to frequent use expert users, the different qualities, the different skills, the different abilities of users that one has to consider. One has to consider their audience in terms of physical, social, perceptual, motor, tactile, the background, the computer skills, the domain knowledge of the users. You have to consider who is the user. Are they primary, secondary, or tertiary? One has to try to elicit requirements in order to analyze them and eventually specify those requirements. Seeking feedback during that requirement solicitation is helpful. You want to make verifiable requirements. Some requirements are not verifiable and probably should be thrown out in favor of requirements that are far more traceable and reliable. Requirements should be correct, complete, consistent, clear, and realistic. Furthermore, there's different kinds of requirements, ranging from business constraints, business requirements, developer constraints, physical setting, external interfaces, non-functional requirements, functional requirements, and user requirements. Requirements are also a major cause of failure of software projects, thus you should consider trying to get your requirements down right. Thank you for your time.